Good morning, everyone. All right. Good morning. Happy Sunday. Have a blessed day in the Lord. Start with announcements. I just have a few brief announcements for you. To start off, today at 11 o'clock, we will all go to the fellowship hall in the cafeteria area for a luncheon. Appreciation luncheon for our church working here. It's like a volunteer appreciation. So you are welcome to go eat. And then when it's done, you can take off. The second thing is this week on Wednesday, there will be no Bible study. Instead, on May 1st, which is this Wednesday, we will have a congregation meeting upstairs. Some of us who are members need to vote on new elders and deacons, so we can go ahead and vote at that meeting, and that happens every year. It's just our annual meeting. This week on Friday, we will have pickleball, so you are welcome to come if you want to play. It's a $5 fee. You can come as a fan or a supporter, which is free, and it'll be going from 6:30 to 9. And finally, on May 18th, which is a Saturday, we have a 4G ladies breakfast, which will be at Cracker Barrel. And that will be in Lakeville at 9 o'clock. So come, have good food, hang out, and that's when we will gather. All right. Any questions about those announcements? That's all I have for announcements today. All right, we'll move on. Time for some praise.
Thank you.
sing. That was our psalm. All right, we'll go ahead and collect prayer requests. Go ahead if there's something on your heart and you want to put it in the box, whatever you need to do, go ahead and write it down and we'll collect them. Next up, we have our love offering, which we will collect. It's just something from your heart to praise and thank Him. Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, your love is perfect. Thank you for taking care of all of us throughout this week and last week and bringing us to today as a new day. Thank you for everything you've done. And we ask that you would bless us today and bless the food that will be served later at 11. Bless our week. And we pray for the senior citizens group who will be going to on their trip as they visit the Creation Museum and the Ark. So just praise be to you for all that planning that has worked out for this group to go down to Kentucky. Please protect them on their travels and bring them back safely. I ask that you bless this, bless us with your Holy Spirit. And have the Holy Spirit inspire Pastor Jeff's sermon today. Please be with us while we think about what it means to apply that message to our heart. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. More praise time. him. Peace be with you all. Are you feeling the peace today? You feel relaxed, sitting back and watching? Or are you all uncomfortable today? How was your week? Is it good? Lousy? So-so? Good? Okay, I'm seeing some thumbs up. No lousy, no bad. Obviously, you guys are doing good. Okay. So, remember last week I was talking about paid in full. How did you feel about that? After the sermon, the rest of the week, if you reflected or anything, well, I guess I should ask, did you reflect or did you just kind of forget it? You could admit it. Some of you reflected and meditated on it, but some of us went back to earth time and struggled to actually pay things in full, maybe. So we wonder, how did Jesus do it? Today, our topic is going to be something different, related to God. So on Thursday and Friday and Saturday this past week, I'm curious if anyone watched the draft. I did. And I'm talking about the football draft, just to clarify. Don't interrupt my sermon. So, how many of you were cheering for the Vikings? Okay, a lot of you. How many of you were cheering for a different team? We don't have to mention my team, right? I don't have to tell you what it is. How many of you were cheering for the Twins? I have like two people. Okay, how many of you were cheering for the Wolves? Or the Wild, I'm sorry. How many of you were cheering for Green Bay? Oh, good. You guys are a good group of people. And how many of you were cheering for the Wolves? We have a couple people who were, one person was cheering for Green Bay on the live stream. So I watched the draft, the football draft, and I'm always curious, like, who's going to be on which team and how they're going to pick them and why they picked certain people. Obviously, they have their needs to meet their team requirements and needs of their team. But the key word that I want to focus on today is for. I mentioned cheering for, but I want you to keep that for in mind. So we're going to begin this service with three pictures. And the first one will kind of help determine the theme for today. So I'm curious what your thoughts are. Let's go ahead and look at the pictures. Okay, so Here's our first picture. We have two angels or two people on each shoulder. Have you felt that before? Where you kind of have like two different opinions? I've always liked the Fred Flintstone image cartoon. We have kind of both sides of the equation. Different kinds of characters, positive and negative. But who is he for? You're supporting the positive side, the angel. Trying to decide which one to follow. Okay. And we should be cheering for Jesus. That would be the best answer. So I'm going to show you the next picture. Now, of course, in this picture, who would you be cheering for? This one should be pretty obvious, right? We're cheering for Jesus, and Jesus is going to win and defeat Satan. And that would be true in any kind of game or competition. You're cheering for one side or the other. And obviously, in this case, we're supporting Jesus, and we're cheering for Jesus, or we should be. And our hearts should be growing and thriving for him. Online, someone said, who wins and who loses? Maybe that determines who we cheer for. And go on to our third picture. All right, a lot of you have probably experienced this particular situation in school or games where you have to pick, you're deciding who your team is, and you might be saying like, oh, pick me, I want to be on this side, I want to be on this team, I don't want to be on this team, right? I'm sure you've all experienced that. But take a look at this picture, and what do you really see? Okay, preferences, they're picking their teams, kind of like the draft in the football, similar concepts. So it's all of the same concept of who we're playing for. Again, that word for. So has anyone figured out what the theme of today's message is going to be? Someone said preferences. What's the theme of today's message? Are you ready? What do you think it is? They said pick one. And that sounds like a Powerball. All right, anyone guess what the theme is? Remember, keeping in mind the word for. All right, we'll go on to the next slide. God is for us. In Romans chapter 8, verses 31 through 39, that's going to be our main verse for today. This is where it talks about God being for us. Now, you might be wondering, God is for us, but what does that really mean? Anyone have any thoughts or guesses related to that? Why am I bringing this up? Why is it important for us to talk about today? Often people might overlook this or not put a lot of focus on this. They're focused on other things in life, but we really need to be focused on God and put him as a priority because he loves us. God made us, and now God wants us and people everywhere to love him, but everyone is just rejecting him. So what do we do? What does God do? He sent his only son, Jesus, to come down to earth and take care of the business that his father bestowed on him. And that is the reason that we can have a relationship with God in the first place. Remember, back in biblical times, there are three instances, well, two or three instances, that it shows God being for us. God destroyed the city of Sodom and Gomorrah, and that he did it for us. And he saved the people who were for him. Another example is God took over the Baal prophets through Elijah and defeated them. And he did that for us. He killed all the prophets that were against God, and he did that for us. These were false prophets that he destroyed, and he stopped them from spreading false messages or rumors or false teachings. Another example is God took down the walls of Jericho, and he took care of it for us. But most importantly, of all of the examples that can be found or discussed, one that stands out of something that God did for us is he defeated sin through death on the cross. Jesus was put to death by death. It doesn't sound right, but remember, everyone dies. But he defeated death so that we can rise again. And that's something that Jesus did for us. And God raised Jesus up from the dead. God is for us. I'll go ahead and show you the main verse for today next. There's five slides, so I'll make sure I give you time to read it. Okay, now that you've had a chance to read it, what do you see in this verse? Is there any comments before I move on? Anything you want to add, mention? Shannon saying, nothing can separate us from the love of God. What else? Now I want to go ahead and show you a picture that relates to this verse. So you see the rope, and it's in the process of being tied in a knot. And knots are not hard, or not easy, I'm sorry, not easy to unravel. It's hard to break it off. And you see, this knot is particularly in the shape of a heart, to represent God's love that will never let go of us and never be disconnected. It's like a knot that's been locked in place. So it's easy to think of, you know, a rope in God's love, and it's bound to us and can't be removed. And God wants you to love him and wants to love you because he is for you and he wants that relationship with you. John describes that God, this is it from the Bible. God, that God's incarnation, which is when he took on flesh, it showed us that Jesus was fully God and fully human at the same time. Jesus came to earth to become one of us, so he can understand how you feel, what your struggles are, what your pain is, before he went back to heaven and became God again and ruled alongside God on his right-hand side. That love is so great for you that he was willing to do that. And he will live forever with you. John chapter 1 verse 14 says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us." So we see his holiness and greatness and blessings became flesh. And he bestowed all of that on his only Son, God the Father, and that the Son would be the Word full of grace and the truth. And who are we talking about? We're talking about Jesus. So Jesus is the Word and became flesh. He's also our Father in heaven. You might be wondering, how is that even possible? Well, the answer is God is for us and one of us. And that's who we should be cheering for and rooting for. In that Romans verse that we just read, Paul wrote, God is for us. For, again, that word, for us. Not God is against us. God is opposing us. That's not what he's saying. It could be easy for God to be like, no, you're not worth it. Go away and just start over with a new creation or something. But that's not what's happening. God wants that relationship with you. And he knows each of us. And he planned our journey. And he planned our creation. And that means he knows everything. We don't know everything. We will probably never fully understand 100% of his perfect plan. But again, God is still for us. And it's easy to see that word or phrase for us, but we still go about our daily lives and do our stuff that we need to get done. And stop remembering that, or stop thinking about it. It doesn't stay in the forefront of our brain. But we need to remember that God is for us and cheering for us on our journey and trying to ensure that we are on the right path. People often will ask, like, is that true? And we know it's true. As Christians, that God is for every one of us. Doesn't matter who we are. Doesn't matter what's going on. We're all sinners the same. No one's better than the other. But he's still for us because of that love that he has for us. And last week we were talking about Jesus has paid it all, paid all of our sins off, and that we can have that feeling of freedom. And God is still for you and looking forward with excitement to encouraging you on your journey and on your right path. I'm going to show you verse 31. I have it highlighted in yellow. So I'm going to make an emphasize a specific point. If God is for us, what can we say about it? It can leave us speechless. Is that true? A lot of you are quiet and just kind of staring at me. But what should we do? We should say, amen. This is true. Praise him. No, he's just for us. Okay. So the question that I have highlighted is, so what should we say about this? We should say, I love you. We should say, praise him. Amen. Thank you. You know what the word amen means is I agree. None of us really probably want to say I disagree. So if God is for us, no one can stand against us. And God is with us. So with that in mind, who would challenge us? Who could break our relationship with God? The devil can't. The devil might try, but he knows God is the most powerful being in the situation. The devil knows that he can't defeat God because he's already been defeated. So again, what should we say? Amen. Every time that you pray, what's the devil want to do? He wants to take away. He wants to take God away or take us away from God. He wants to disrupt your faith or dismantle it. So we see the question in this verse is an encouragement, and it can help us stay positive and remember that nothing can stand against us. He did not withhold his son Jesus. He didn't do that. He sent him down to us. So if God did withhold his son, what would have happened? There would have been chaos. What else? Nothing would have happened, maybe. Maybe we wouldn't be here today. But that withholding, he didn't do. He sent his love with Jesus because he knew what would happen. Now imagine, God is like some of you are parents. So if you decided to withhold your kids from something and said, no, I'm not sending them. That's maybe what you want to do, but you have to give them up and give them the opportunity to go through life. And I know, you know, there's people getting married soon. There's a lot of emotions going. But you have to give up your daughter to be married and become one with their spouse. And then you would gain a new son-in-law. So it's maybe sad to let them go and see a new chapter in their life, but there's also gain. It's be the same with God. He has to let his son go, knowing what the result would be that he would gain children through his son's death. And that we could have eternal life with him. And that's exciting and a happy thought to have. Just like the emotions, what I was talking about fluctuating. There's another situation here who's a mother. Or another person here who's a mother who may not want to let go of their child and let them go out into the world. But when they do, they see all the excitement that that child has. So God sent Jesus for all of us. Every single person. He didn't pick and choose and say, oh, you're good enough and you're not. No, no, no. He sent him for all of us. God will give us and take care of us by giving us everything we need, which means he is for us. Every time we write down a prayer request or have one in our thoughts or pray in our thoughts and have that conversation with God, God will meet your needs. Sometimes the answer is yes, but he knows us well and he knows our hearts. If we say, oh, I want something, and God might say, you know, we don't need that. God knows what we need better than we do. So verse 37, I want to point this one out too. I want to emphasize the word but in this verse. But in all these troubles, we have complete victory through God who has shown his love for us. Now the verse says troubles, and that can mean whatever we experience through our journey of life. You know, we often meet frustrations or oppression, or where we hit a wall, we don't really know where to go. Maybe we want that job but we don't get it, or we want a good life, but we have a lot of struggles or sickness or whatever. Whatever you experience in your daily life or journey, think of an analogy of like a tree branch. You have a big tree full of branches, and that shows our journey and how many paths we have. And God sees all of those branches and all of those places that we're going to go, but we maybe can't see it. During our troubles, we need to be joyful because God is with us. Paul was considering a question, or his rhetorical question, is not meant to suggest that no one is against us. However, it means that no one and nothing that is opposed to us can actually defeat us, because Christ is with us and we are in relationship with Christ. So there are some people out there who will do anything to try to hurt you. They might be backstabbers or spread false rumors about you. Maybe they spread false information. But we can still stand firm and trust in God. God didn't give up his faith in you. You don't need to give up your faith in God, no matter what people do against you. Because those people, as much as they sin against you or try to defeat you, cannot defeat your relationship with God. Nothing will be able to separate us from him. Because God is for us. We are more than, I'm going to use the word conquerors. Conquerors, so you know, God raised Jesus up from the dead and he conquered death. And we were all rooting for him and cheering because we knew that he would live forever and that we would be able to live forever with Jesus. And we know that we will die first, as everybody who is human will, but then we will be with Jesus, together. Because God is for us and has increased his family. Nothing. Again, nothing will be able to separate us from God's love. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, nothing can separate us. That's true. There's nothing, there's no thing that can break our relationship. As kids, we would say, sign like, broke up, you know what I mean? Someone's laughing. But nothing can break us up from God. That relationship is too hard to break because Jesus did everything on the cross for us. And that was all a part of his plan. So let's go to verse 39. Nothing will ever separate us from the love of God, from the love God has shown us in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the last verse in this section of verses that I'm using for our sermon today. Absolutely. You have a sign for absolutely? True biz. Absolutely nothing can separate us, can get between us, between us and God. If another person, maybe who doesn't know Jesus yet, feels like they can separate us from God, that they can't. If we have accepted Jesus into our heart, you will not be separated from God. That bond is strong no matter how long you have accepted him or not. Jesus died for us over 2,000 years ago. But that is still continuing. And it will continue to have that relationship with us that nothing can stop and nothing can break. So again, God is for us, and we should be cheering and supporting him in return. And remember that question, what should we say about it? Tell the world. Talk about Jesus. Share the news. What are we waiting for? Don't be shy. Why are you being shy? Jesus paid the ultimate price and the ultimate pain by taking on our sin on the cross. None of us want to be nailed to a cross. But Jesus didn't complain about it. He did it for us. He was a fully innocent person who hadn't even sinned once in his life. And we sin a lot. But because of his love, he conquered it all, and his love is just that powerful. So my next question for you is, how can we apply these verses in our life? I have 5 items for you. Focus. Beyond what we can see. What I mean by that is, if we're, for example, if you're on vacation for a month and you're looking forward to it or whatever, you might forget God. We forget to focus on our relationship with God. And we can do that through prayer, by talking with God. Or if you're angry, talk to God too. Tell him that you're angry. He won't talk back. He'll listen. So that first word is focus. Don't focus yourself on other things, only that we can see or that are tangible to us. Focus on God and things that we can't see. Second thing is sometimes we see situations pop up or opportunities show up. And we want to seize those opportunities and seize the moment. We want to seize those opportunities that may never come up again. And what I mean by that is, I'm going to use Shannon as an example. See, Shannon sees a group that's kind of arguing or in a heated discussion because they're talking about something related to the Bible. And Shannon observes this and seizes that opportunity to represent God and goes over and explains, like, what's your question or what are you trying to solve? And she can minister to them and explain, like, well, this is what the Bible says about it or what Jesus says about it. That's an opportunity that may not happen again, with those people at least. So you need to seize the moment. Take advantage of that time to be a witness and not avoid doing that. So those are our first two. The third one I have is act on our priorities. How do we set our priorities? How do you maintain your faith? You might have conversation, relationship with God, but where is that on your priority list? A priority for you might be going to church, fellowship with other Christians, or fellowship in Jesus' name, or Bible study classes, or maybe on your own time reading the Bible, or worshiping, or having a worship book. So set your priorities, and then act on them. Maybe you have a Bible, and you're just like, oh, I'm just gonna leave it there, and it just collects dust, and isn't really doing anything, because you haven't really opened it. Open it! Pick one verse or one chunk of chapters, a few minutes even. It doesn't take all day. Then put it back down. But just take a few minutes every day and set your priorities on how you want to represent God. And then act on those priorities. Our fourth one is walk in the Spirit. So our worldly wants don't overwhelm us. We have things we want on earth, worldly things. But if we walk in the Spirit versus walking with what the world says or what the world wants, we won't be overwhelmed. And again, it's just balancing that on how we can preserve and maintain our faith and trust in God. And that also ties back into where our priorities lie. Sometimes we become dissatisfied. But remember, God is for us. And we need to focus our attention back on Him and have that relationship instead of it being one-sided. And setting a priority is not easy, regardless of what the priority is. It can be challenging. But again, you can get better at it by practicing and disciplining yourself and setting those priorities. And maybe God will kind of discipline you along the way, and then you'll be ready for what's next and ready for your next home in heaven. And sometimes, when you set those priorities and walk in the Spirit, people will notice. People notice your grace and the glow on your face and the joy that you just exude. And lastly, today we can add to make sure that our priorities can survive and thrive during suffering or trials or something that comes up to disrupt our priority. You have your priority set and you want to make sure you keep with it and stick with it and not fail. And you're adamant and you're determined and it's growing. And then something happens and a time of suffering arrives. And there's a verse that says, unfortunately, or I'm sorry, during your mourning and your sadness, that we still should praise him. We should praise that we're still alive, that we still have his faith, that he gave his life. One example that just comes to mind is in 2010, some of you already know this story. It's about me and Lynn, my wife. We were driving a car and the car flipped over. And I thought, that's it. That's the end of my life. But no. My life on earth was not over. And a few years later, I became a pastor. And it's funny how God has used that example or that story to continue my priorities and my growth. And my car was totaled. I mean, it was useless. I had no car. But then I understood that his plan was different than my plan. And his plan was still perfect, even during that suffering. I can look back and honestly be happy it happened. I know that sounds harsh and rude and weird, but you have to understand that his purpose is to be for us. And he's for you as much as he's for me. So, all of those points to say, Jesus, the risen Son of God, is interceding for you. He's involved. He's a mediator between you and the Father. And nothing can separate you from his love. Jesus is for you and interceding for you to bring that union between you and the Father. I want to show you another verse, or I'm sorry, another picture. So this was from the Romans chapter 8, 31 through 39. And this picture really shows that God is for us. And there's a lot of different choices, but I picked as best as I can to represent this. But I want to show you a verse that really represents this for us. It's from a different book of the Bible. It's from Matthew. So Matthew chapter 1 verse 23, and you know the story well. It's our Christmas story, but it says, the virgin will be pregnant and give birth to a son. They will name him Emmanuel. Emmanuel means God with us. So his name actually means God's with us, and that's Jesus they're talking about. And that God with us means God is for us. So what should we say about it? Amen. That's what we should say. Amen. One more time. Amen. There we go. That's much better. All right. So let's go on to our questions. Is it true or false that King David made preparation for the building of the temple? How many vote true? How many vote false? How many don't know? The answer is true. From 1 Chronicles, chapter 22, verses 1 through 5, David said, "The temple of the Lord God and the altar for burning offerings for the Israelites will be built here." David gave an order for all foreigners living in Israel to be gathered together. He chose stone cutters from that group of foreigners. Their job was to cut stones ready to be used for the building of God's temple. David got iron for making nails and hinges for the gate doors. He also got more bronze than could be weighed and more cedar logs than could be counted. The people from the cities of Sidon and Tyre brought many cedar logs to David. David said, "We should build a very great temple for the Lord, but my son Solomon is young and does not yet have enough experience to know how to do it well. It should be so great and beautiful that it will be famous among all the nations. So I will prepare what is needed to build it." So before David died, he prepared everything needed to build a great temple. And then our next question, true or false? One of the kings of Judah, on account of his great wickedness, was not accorded the customary royal honors at his death. True or false? He didn't get the honors that most kings would receive. True? False? Don't know? And the answer is true. 2 Chronicles, chapter 21, verses 16 through 20. The Lord caused the Philistines and the Arabs living near the Ethiopians to be angry with Jehoram. They attacked Judah and carried away all the riches in the king's palace. They also took Jehoram's sons and wives. Only Jehoram's youngest son, Ahaziah, was left. After this happened, the Lord made Jehoram sick with a disease in his intestines that could not be cured. His intestines fell out 2 years later because of his sickness. He died in very bad pain. The people did not make a large fire to honor Jehoram as they did for his father. Jehoram was 32 years old when he became king. He ruled 8 years in Jerusalem. No one was sad when he died. The people buried Jehoram in the city of David. And now our final question. Is it true or false that three of the Gospels were written by Paul's assistants? How many say true? How many say false? How many don't know? Only two. The answer is false. Luke and Mark. That was a kind of a trick question. All right. And now for our final part before you are all starving for food. Some funny pictures. The first one is from Shannon and her trip. She took some pictures and shared with us. All right. She was driving and spotted this bulletin board, billboard. Where did you see this one again? She said in Maryland. She saw that one. Cool. Our next picture was also from Shannon, from her trip. She was on the subway and saw this. It's a advertisement for the Bible app. 0 stars. Would not recommend. From Satan. And Julie was saying, look, 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 take a picture. Wanted to make sure we got that. Okay. All right. Give credit where credit's due. So you know when you like go to a hotel or restaurant and you give ratings, like top 5 is like the best you could ever have, 0 is the worst, and this is from Satan. So of course he would say the Bible app is 0 stars. And that was in the subway. In New York City. All right, and the next one, the final one is from Julie. You have to look carefully at the words. Ready? So the little boy is praying over their meal. And he says, oh, I want to thank you, Lord, for all you have given us. And in return, I hope that you like this burnt offering. You know, in the Old Testament days, they would offer burnt offerings before Jesus died for us. But his mom cooked it, and he's saying it's burnt. So he's like, I hope you accept this burnt offering that my mother prepared for you. And it looks like it's supposed to be a turkey or a chicken or something. But anyway, that one was a good one. All right. We'll close this out here with a prayer and a blessing. All right, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All right, before I bless you, I just want to remind everybody that next week we'll have a guest speaker, James Johnson, here for the month of May. Just wanted to give you that reminder. I encourage you to spread the word that he will be in town. Bring your friends. Now the blessing for you. May God go before you to guide you. May he go behind you to encourage you, with you to be a friend, above you to watch over you, and within you to give you peace. Now our closing prayer. Please join me in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we just thank you that you are for us. That you have given us everything that we need. And Lord, we thank you that you love us and you have loved us from the beginning. And you will continue to love us all the way to end, to the end. Let us rest in your love through whatever struggles or trials or triumphs and victories that we have. Let your unchanging and unfailing love be our stronghold and the fortress of our souls for all of us. We just thank you for everything. And as we meditate on today and wonder just how can we even measure the depth of your love and understand you better and understand that love better, regardless of what situations happen, we know that you are with us and your love is for us because you sent your son Jesus to come down to earth, to become man, and to walk the journey of life, die on the cross for our sins, and that was all part of your plan. So gather your people together so that we may be in relationship with you like you took away our sins, and that we may have a full relationship and resting place forever with you. Help us to understand as best as we can your love for us that you have. We give you all of the prayer requests and needs from our congregation and turn them over to you. And not just the ones that are on paper, but the ones that are in our thoughts and in our hearts and from the people on the live stream. Because you know all of our needs. So we ask you to take care of it. And know that you are for us. So we thank you. And as we gather here together today and socialize over lunch, and we join with the hearing church or go home, we ask for your protection and to watch over us, no matter where we're going. Even in the exciting moments, not just the bad ones. And as spring is coming, keep us protected as we go outside and do things and experience your creation. You take care of the grass, the flowers, and even the weeds, even if we don't know why they're there, but they're all your creation. So thank you. And all in Jesus' name we say, amen. God be with you.